This is celebrating 66 verses 1 and 4.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate, But you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 36, verses 5 through 10, found in your service bulletin or in the Book of Common Prayer on page 632. We will read responsively whole verse by whole verse, the last verse all together. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the clouds.
Your righteousness is like the strong mountains, your justice is like the great deep.
How priceless is your love, O God. Your people take refuge under the shadow of your wings.
They feast upon the abundance of your house. You give them drink from the river of your delights.
For with you is the well of life, and in your light we see light. Continue your loving kindness to those who know you, and your favor to those who are true of heart. Our second reading is from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, let Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith, by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, and to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
to you, Lord Christ.
On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. The mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, standing there were 6 stone water jugs for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." They filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine, he did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. Out of curiosity, has anybody here ever seen the movie Inside Out? It's one of those Pixar animation children's films.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. If you haven't seen it, I'll just recap it very briefly for you. It's a movie that all takes place within this little girl's head, a little 10-year-old girl named Riley. And throughout the movie, you're watching her emotions, who are the main characters of the show. You have joy, you have disgust, you have fear, you have anger, and then you have sadness. And throughout this movie, they're all interacting with each other. And Joy kind of thinks that she's the star of the show. She's the one that's kind of leading Riley in most of her activities and most of the things that she does. She's front and center all the time, bright and bubbly. She's always making her presence known. And then an accident happens, and Joy and Sorrow get separated from the rest of the group, and they have to slowly find their way back. And Joy doesn't really like Sorrow, doesn't really like sadness. Joy thinks that sadness is a little awkward, a little uncomfortable, has a tendency to say the wrong thing at the wrong time. So she tries to kind of hide sadness away. But since they're separated and they're kind of stuck with each other, Joy and sadness have to find a way back to the rest of the group. And as they do, Joy sees that sadness also has strengths. Joy sees that sadness has skills that she can't do, that she's able to heal people in ways that Joy can't. That she also is worthwhile and has value and virtue. It's remarkable, because as she comes back, she recognizes that they don't all have to be joy. They don't all have to be anger or disgust or fear, but there's strength in that kind of diversity. The first letter to the Corinthians that we heard this morning, the second reading, is all about that, finding joy in diversity, that we don't all have to be the same one. The city of Corinth, back in the ancient world, was incredibly immense. It was one of the largest cities in the Roman Empire. And there was people from all over the world that gathered there. You had people from Syria, you had people from Africa, people from Rome, people from Spain, Portugal, all over the place. And a lot of them converged over in Corinth. And many of them ended up joining the Christian church. And that's a huge variety of people. Not just from different locations who are all bringing their different cultures, traditions, languages, all of that. But you also had people who were of different representations of society. You have people who were slaves and very impoverished. You have people who were aristocrats and very wealthy. The treasurer of Corinth, the whole city, was actually a member of this church. So he had this huge variety of people. And to further complicate things, they had received a variety of preachers who had come to them over the years to proclaim the good news. But it caused a little bit of confusion. You had some people who said, oh, I follow Paul. You have other people, oh, I follow Apollos. Right? Oh, I follow Jesus. There's all this kind of division. There were these fractions that were kind of making themselves known, starting to separate the congregation. So the letter that Paul writes to them that we just heard is urging that unity, that regardless of all those differences that they have, that they're all rooted in Christ, that the unity they find grafted onto the tree of Christ, life of the world, that that overshadows any other divide or any other difference that could possibly make an impact, which is just as true for us. One of the beautiful things about our tradition and being Episcopalians is that a lot of things in our theology aren't defined in specific ways, but in terms. There's a spectrum. You have people who are very conservative and people who are very liberal, and everybody in between. And there's a strength in that. That's something worth celebrating and giving thanks for, that we aren't all the same, that we're all many different parts of the same body of Christ. Because that's where we get our strength from. That we can rely on each other when we bump up against something that we can't do on our own. And I find it very interesting that this happens to be the lectionary reading on the eve of Martin Luther King Day, whose entire life was about emphasizing unity amongst diversity. When we recognize that we can celebrate one another's differences, that we can give thanks for them, then we get a bit closer to that kingdom of God, to the kingdom of heaven where all are together. It's unity, not uniformity. There's a subtle difference there. And that's where the celebration happens. Think of the gospel. The first act that Jesus does in his ministry, the first miracle, he doesn't heal somebody, he doesn't bring sight to the blind, he doesn't heal a crippled person or somebody with leprosy. Turns water to wine. He celebrates with the diverse community of God, diverse people who were also at that wedding. When we recognize and celebrate our differences, God celebrates with us. And that's something that we can all give thanks and praise for. Amen. Turning to page 358, together let us stand and proclaim the words of our faith as found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic.
forth from baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Here's the people, Form 4 on page 388.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Jennifer, our bishop, Father TJ, our priest in charge, and from the diocesan cycle of prayer, St. Luke's, Kendleton, Miss Lucy Goffinet, senior warden of prayer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Grant Cook, Sam and Savory Graves, Gary Farmer, Heather Duchess, Allison Duchess Delvecchio, Joan Lewis, David Jenkins, and Joni Neuwirth. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, including Eric Schridman and Nan Watson, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Turn to page 360 or your service bulletin. Together, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Morning again. You can be seated for just a few moments for a couple of announcements. First, just a reminder that I am not going to be in the office this week, I'm going to be at a conference with Virginia Theological Seminary. But if there's anything urgent that comes up that you need to get a hold of me, you can call the office during office hours, or my pastoral cell phone number and my business cards are on the table in the narthex if you need that. So I won't be in the office this week. A reminder that the end of the month, on the 30th, we have our annual meeting, which is going to be taking place right now during the 10 o'clock service. And if you haven't been to one before, I encourage you to come. And I especially encourage you to come to this one, because this one's going to be uniquely exciting. We have a bit of an announcement that I'm going to kind of tease. Well, I'm not going to tease, I'm just going to tell you. I'm sure you all remember Elsie Oldney, who was a beloved member of the congregation for many, many years, who sadly passed almost 2 years ago now. Yeah, a year ago now. She left a bequest to St. Michael's. And with those funds, we have been able to pay off the mortgage that St. Michael's has been paying. The debt that we've had for the renovation that has been a sizable one, St. Michael's is now debt-free, which is amazing. And I also want to temper that, because that doesn't mean we're off in the clear. We do still have some financial challenges that we need to take care of. But that's a huge hurdle that we've overcome, and that is worth celebrating and giving thanks and praise for. So come to the annual meeting, because during the annual meeting, we are going to burn the mortgage, like literally and physically, right here. So I encourage you all to come. And those were my only announcements. Vestry minutes and financial stuff has been printed out from our last meeting and is up in the narthex. So.
For accepting new members to the choir, if you know any singers, tell them we'd love to have them with us. What?
There's room. Yeah.
Like she said, there's room.
We'll make more.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. At the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Behold the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Together, let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, We thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. This is to celebrate 152.
Peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.